Welcome back to the Coliseum. We're at the midway point of day number four as it's high noon on the last day of competition at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Amanda Krenz with you here in Madison, Wisconsin. And Dave just revealed it a little bit ago, the 2-2-2-3 interval.
It's not often we get to kind of dictate the time domain and rest scheme for a lot of these athletes. And you see that rope. We have a 20-foot rope. The ski erg is coming out for the individuals for the very first time this weekend. And behind that, you have some heavy barbells. And what you can't see is how far down the floor they're going to have to go. 75 overhead squats total to finish this event.
Now, stay with me here, everybody. Dave Castro was apologetic for this one. For more there, we go to Amanda Krenz.
Before Dave Castro even announced this event, he was making that apology. He said, I'm sorry, but not to you, the athletes. I'm sorry about your legs because they are going to do some more squatting. These athletes are experiencing some lower body fatigue right now, especially in those quads. They were talking about that yesterday, and they've had more events since then. But these athletes are incredibly fit. They're the fittest in the world. We'll see if some muscle fatigue is enough to slow them down.
Thank you, Amanda. As we're nearing the end of the weekend of competition, our first heat of athletes here in event number 12 include a couple of promising people in terms of setting a good time to beat. And in lane number four, one of those will be Lauren Fisher.
You see Lauren Fisher in the center part of your screen, as well as Madeline Sturt. Both of these athletes I kind of have my eye on. He said, you need to have some strong legs for multiple reps. Lauren Fisher's got herself some strong reins. And I love the way Madeline Sturt's been competing all week. And look, she's only 20 years old. She looks like a baby out there. She's done great so far.
This is the first of four intervals, the first of three that are 2 minutes long. It starts with a long climb almost to the ceiling of this arena, 20 feet high.
Well, you know, it's a tall climb if you can't even fit the entire rope within the screen on your TV, and it is 20 feet high. And there's a little extra at the top. The distance they climb is 20 feet, but they're standing on top of that 3 foot high crash pad. So if you are afraid of heights, putting yourself over 20 feet in the air is not a settling thing to do.
Two rope climbs done for the entire field. They start on 7 calories on the Concept 2 ski erg. This is a device that not many people have gotten to experience at their gym.
You see two different styles of technique. Sometimes you see that big sweeping motion or that short just kind of dig. You see in lane number 7, it actually is Jessica Griffith. I like the way she sweeps around. Lauren Fisher opting for just that straight down pull, and they're going really hard. And you gotta understand is that they only have 2 minutes to get as many overhead squats as possible. There's only 45 seconds left.
And they can get as many overhead squats as they can. Every 10 reps within the first 30, they will advance the bar. Jessica Griffith will be the leader after the first 10.
And even though you're starting with two 20-foot climbs and the ski erg in between, the total scored portion of this event is basically 75 overhead squats for time, but they can only work in 2-minute intervals for the first three sections, and then they'll get a minute break. Now, you might think that's a nice gift he's given to these athletes, but interval sprint workouts, that minute tends to really make this harder because you need to push hard early in this round if you want to try to get deep into these overhead squat sets.
Jessica Griffith getting 24 overhead squats, 3 better than Lauren Fisher, 5 better than Alexis Johnson in third. Griffith's name in blue as she is the leader. Everybody else will have their name in red, showing how many reps they are behind. And as they're 20 seconds into this 1 minute break, you can finish this in 3 rounds if you push the tempo. Griffith was almost at that pace needed.
I mean, numerically, it seems like it is possible to do, but what you're gonna have to do is keep that intensity high, but it's really difficult to do. 2 minutes is just long enough to push you to your brink of muscle fatigue and muscle failure. We have such a heavy overhead squat. We're talking about 105 pounds on this barbell. They have to do 75 total squats. And if you think this minute went by fast when you're watching, it is about light speed for those athletes on the floor.
And we are back to the buy-in portion as we start interval number two. Griffith in the lead of 24 overhead squats.
The object is to maximize as much time as you can on the barbell, but you don't want to sacrifice basically your grip in your arms. All we're doing is a massive upper body pulling movement with the rope climb. Then we're switching to the ski erg where they have to do seven cals. Also a upper body sprint movement. So not only are your arms tired, but that sprint is sapping your lungs at the same time. Overhead squats are hard enough, especially at that load of 105. So this is a very deceptive event for these athletes.
Mentioned that numerically Griffith was almost on that pace, needed to finish this in three rounds. Say somebody does get rep 75 in that third 2 minute window, they still owe two rope climbs, seven calories on the ski erg in that fourth interval, and then a sprint to the finish line.
In the first round, Griffith had about 45 seconds to tap in and get those overhead squats, and it's pretty close. We have a lot of athletes coming off at the same time.
Griffith and Fisher are the only two that are working towards rep number 30. Once they pass that 30th rep, it's no longer moving forward every 10, it's moving forward every 3. 30 in the book for Jessica Griffith, rookie out of the Central Regional.
And now once you get through the set of 30, you're moving up by every 10. This is when it starts to get very fun and interesting because they're going to advance every 3 repetitions. What's hard about that is that holding that bar over your head and walking is very tough in that overhead position to do.
The 2 minute intervals are where you get the score, but where you might have your best moment is in the 1 minute break. For more there, we go to Amanda Krenz.
Athletes that I talked to in the warm-up area right before this event said a lot of them train with intervals, so they are excited to see this event. But different athletes have different thoughts about these breaks that you get. On one hand, you get that chance to recover. That rest is nice. You also get a chance to look around, measure up where your competitors are on the field. The danger here is that you could start to overthink things a little bit and maybe lose some focus, too.
Thanks, Amanda. And it's kind of nice to see this because this is the kind of thing you would see more at your gym as opposed to some of the events that you can get at the games.
Absolutely. And how many different tests have we had? This is event number 12. And we've changed the weights. We've changed the rep schemes. We've changed the field of play. The weather has made changes for the type of environment that they're going to compete in. And now instead of saying, here's 75 overhead squats, go do it for time. What we're doing is that we're only allotting a certain amount of time and then throwing the rope climbs and ski ergs. This doesn't even count to your overall score. The only thing they're counting on the left side of your screen is how many overhead squats they've actually completed to this point in time. This is their last 2 minute section. And I tell you what, 20 feet, you're like, oh, it's just 5 feet higher. It is 5 feet higher, but when you think about how difficult rope climbs can be, and we said, is the pull going to affect the overhead squats? Well, let's flip that around. The overhead squats are actually going to be more detrimental to the beginning of every event on everyone's pull because you're holding onto a barbell, but what an overhead position does to your hands is it smokes your grip and taxes your forearms.
And there's a no rep for Alexis Johnson. She currently sits in the third position. You see her still standing on the crash pad. And this is huge because she was only 5 reps behind Jessica Griffith on the overhead squat. She might not even get to the bar this round. Valerie Vober will be first to the barbell. She's at 27 overhead squats. Lauren Fisher is at 34 overhead squats, second place. She gets to the bar a good chunk of time faster than the leader, Jessica Griffith, who snatches her first rep, catches it below parallel, and stands it up. That is a good overhead squat.
Yes.
Jessica Griffith working towards rep 45. She has a one rep lead over Lauren Fisher in the blue tank top on the left side of the screen. And we will advance to our final 3 minute interval with Jessica Griffith in the lead at 45. Lauren Fisher two reps back. Casey Campbell 10 back at 35. And Alexis Johnson goes from third to dead last at 33 after that no rep.
And you know, and that's, if you're not going to make it up the rope, obviously you want to think about safety to begin with. That's a very high place to get to if you don't have grip fatigue. And the penalty really is that you got zero repetitions to your total score. Now it's going to change after this round. We've gone through three rounds of 2 minutes on, 1 minute off. This final set, they are going to get three total minutes to get as far as they can. Griffith is leading with 45 total overhead squats, but Fisher is only two reps behind her. Sturt just below her, nine reps back. I would say is that you don't want to race through this too much because the grip is definitely have been smoked. And I think some of these athletes, if you ask them after this, I believe coming in, they thought the rope and the ski erg was going to hurt the overhead squats. I'm almost willing to say you might want to flip that. I think the overhead squats are actually making the rope and ski erg harder, and it's become less about the weight at the end and more about how difficult these ropes are at the beginning.
Yellow sports bra and black and white pants is Alexis Johnson, the number 53 on the top of the screen. She's still going. There is no minimum work requirement within every interval in itself. There is in the event overall. So she is fine, even though she did not complete the two rope climbs in interval number three. And she just coasted through her two as Jessica Griffith is starting to struggle on these rope climbs. She does get the touch on rep number two and will make her way to the ski erg, but look at the fatigue in the face of Jessica Griffith after she's been looking really comfortable the first three intervals. 2 minutes remain. We're working towards the 12-minute mark, which is our overall time cap in the 2-2-2-3 interval as we're in our fourth and final round. This is the only one that is 3 minutes. Alexis Johnson got some rest. You just saw her leave the ski erg. She might catch back up in this. Lauren Fisher is a few spots on the floor ahead, and she's at 43. She'll take the lead as Griffith is still putting in work on the ski erg.
And coming into this event, we talked about the legs just getting annihilated with 75 overhead squats. But I said that Fisher's strength in her legs would benefit her, but also her experience on the games floor. 20 feet is not a normal height that most affiliates have the luxury of having when it comes to rope climb. So most of your experience is going to come from a stage such as the CrossFit Games.
Two rep differential, Jessica Griffith on the near side of the screen, Lauren Fisher on the top of the screen. That's the battle for the lead here in the heat. Griffith will drop it with 45 seconds remaining. Fisher has held on since the very start of the overhead squats here in the final round.
What's good for Lauren Fisher is that her Olympic lifting background is paying off because she can get in such good overhead positions. Look how close her hands are. Base off what your normal overhead squat width would be. The ability to do that allows you to have a more supportive position instead of being wide because you don't have the flexibility to get there.
Lauren struggling to get back on it after holding that bar over her head for over a minute straight. Struggling to get that lockout. Griffith drops on the backside of the screen. She won't catch Lauren Fisher, who will have the score to beat coming out of heat number one. 63 out of the 75 overhead squats. That was the goal.
And a lot of this comes down to how good are you at moving? Are you a good mover? We saw that some of the best athletes out of the regions with those dumbbell overhead squats couldn't just outwork other competitors, but you actually had to do the work well from a technical standpoint. When you have people that specialize in something like Olympic lifting, they have just a mechanical advantage right off the bat, being able to put yourself in better positioning, which is what you're going to need under fatigue with these overhead squats.
So Lauren Fisher setting the score to beat 63 overhead squats. Jessica Griffith at 61. Carly Fuhrer rounding out the top three at 53 as we're ready for heat number two coming up next. So our second heat of four in the 2-2-2-3 intervals. Women's event number 12 of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games is here and now at the Alliant Energy Center. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Amanda Krenz with you in Madison, Wisconsin. It's kind of an interesting feel to an event, something you normally don't see at the games.
You don't see it at the games necessarily, but you should see this a lot in people's trainings. We have interval work. They have a designated 2-minute time cap for three rounds in a row with a 1-minute break. And you're gonna start with rope climbs and a skier, but the goal is to achieve 75 overhead squats at 105 pounds. The final round, 3 minutes total to see if you can get to 75. The best we've seen so far, 63.
About an hour ago, Dave Castro announced this event. He also had a special message to the athletes. For more there, we go to Amanda Krenz.
Before Dave Castro even released the details of what this event was going to be, he started apologizing to the athletes. Well, not exactly the athletes. He said he was sorry about their legs because they're going to be doing some more squatting. These CrossFit Games so far have been a lot of work for the lower body. These athletes are experiencing some of that lower body fatigue right now, especially in their quads. They were even talking about this yesterday, and we've had more events since then. They are incredibly fit, though. We'll see if that slows them down at all.
Thank you, Amanda. The second wave of athletes that have their legs just beat up even more this weekend are here in heat number two, a field of nine. And one athlete that you're looking at is somebody that's had absolute magic here on the floor in Madison, Alethea Boone.
Well, someone who's just so good at rope climbs, Alethea Boone. When we saw the later heats or the later rounds in the previous event, the rope climbs became a big hurdle for a lot of these athletes. She also gets in very good positions. Want to talk about strong legs? How about someone who's finishing in the top 10 in the clean event? Reagan Huckabee. Got my eye on her, too.
Away we go with interval number one of four. The first of 3 2-minute intervals that these athletes will have. This is the buy-in portion, 2 rope climbs, 7 calories on the skier.
I mean, looking for these athletes is to be able to adapt as things unfold in front of them. You have 4 opportunities to change schemes up, so you have to be able to adapt on the fly. The other thing is that just having good positioning throughout, it's still about technique rather than grunt work. We already did the grunt work earlier this morning on the soccer field. Now it's time to be technical with these barbells.
Whitney Yellen in the purple shirt, blue pants, first to the skier. One lane over to her right is Alethea Boone. She was second place getting there.
7 cals on the skier. And in the first round, when you're fresh, yes, the rope climbs and the ski ergs are in there to make the overhead squats more challenging. What your goal is in the first round is kind of play to your strengths. If you're good at overhead squats, just keep moving as long as you feel like you're not going to redline. The last thing you want to do in the very first round is to get to that shaky grip, shaky elbow locked out position, knowing full well you have 3 more iterations of this event to go.
Every 10 completed overhead squats up to rep number 30, the athletes will advance that 105 pound bar forward. Beyond rep 30, they'll advance it forward every 3 reps towards the south end of the Alliant Energy Center floor. 30 seconds remaining in our opening 2-minute interval before a 1-minute break. Whitney Yellen in the purple and blue leading the way at 15 completed overhead squats. Her name highlighted in blue as the leader. Everybody else will be in red with the minus number showing how many reps they are behind the lead.
And one thing you got to think about, and you said about good positioning, look at Whitney Galen's grip. Look at her shoulders. That is a, it is not an ideal position to be in overhead squash. Now, she got a lot of reps in, but that type of technique will not last as you move down the line. Now, she might be strong enough to just muscle through it. What you want to see is that your arms are going to get smoked. Your grip's going to get smoked. It's going to be very hard to stabilize that bar. That's a very dangerous position to be in if you don't have good technique in that overhead position.
In heat number one, a dangerous position to be in, turned out to be the leader after the first interval. Jessica Griffith was at 24 reps in heat number one. She finished second, getting passed by Lauren Fisher. The leader after one round here, Reagan Huckabee, also at 24 reps.
And the only thing I saw from Reagan Huckabee is that she had a little bit of a struggle with her footing on the rope climb. And a lot of that is just getting used to the rope itself. You know, it could be a new rope. You could be excited. When you wrap your feet, sometimes you'll accidentally kick it out of your hands. I said Boone coming in as one of the best rope climb. Shoot, she could do this whole thing legless if she wanted to. She's on the bottom right side of your screen. In the previous 2-minute interval, if you could do a touch and go rep doing rope climbs, I'm not sure exactly how you would phrase that, but she landed and leaped right from the bottom back up to the rope on the last one. Taking a little bit of a break here. Now what Galin's strength is exactly that. She's just one of the strongest athletes in the field. Just a tough, gritty one too. But Boone, she has vice grips for hands. What she can do with legless rope climbs, now when you throw your legs in there, it just makes what she's good at a lot easier.
Alethea Boone, I'm not even so much sure if she was faster on the way up, but fastest on the way down. You saw Whitney Galin also doing a similar slide down the rope. Bethany Branham on the far left side, also onto the ski erg, was doing that climb down. That could make a huge difference in the end.
Well, it has a huge impact on your grip. Sometimes, we talked about this on the cargo net in the obstacle course. Crawling down happens to be harder than crawling up, depending on how you work your way down. On rope climbs, same type of deal. If you don't know how to descend slowly and smoothly, climbing down is actually might be much more taxing on your grip than the way up.
First to the bar here in interval number two is Kirsten Pedry on the far left side of the screen, as she's working towards rep number 30. Anna Tobias in lane number two in blue and pink leading the way now, as she got to the bar quicker than Huckabee did, who just now got to the bar. So Tobias will advance to the 3-rep advance portion of the floor. She's past rep 30.
I said, if you want to get some reps in, you need to make sure you give yourself time.
Working to the 5-minute mark when the next rest interval will start. And as they hit the rest period, let's go for an update to Amanda Krenz.
Athletes that I talked to in the warm-up area right before this event said a lot of them train with these intervals, with these rests, so they're excited to see this in a CrossFit Games event. But there are some different opinions about it. On one hand, you get that chance to recover. That rest is nice. You also get a chance to look around, measure up where your competitors are on the field. The danger with that sometimes is that you can start to overthink things in that minute, or maybe lose some focus. Something to take note of when these athletes start climbing up the rope again, just a little over halfway up, you're going to see a tape mark. That's more important to notice on their way back down. One of the standards for this event is that the athlete's hands have to be on that rope on their way back down below that black tape before they can let themselves fly off. That's a big safety risk there. We've actually seen most athletes going a little bit below that black tape mark because it's still pretty high up there, guys.
And that rope back in use here as interval number 3 underway. This is the last 2-minute window before another 1 minute of rest. After the first two rounds, one heat ago, the lead was 38 reps. Anna Tobias in at 39 here in heat number 2 to lead the way. 2 reps clear of Kirsten Pedry, who was 5th out of the 9 athletes after the first interval, but got to the bar so quick she gained ground, picked up 3 spots.
They did, and there's 2 ways to get more reps. You either give yourself more time on the front end to get more time on the bar, or when you get to the bar, you make best of what the time that you have. We saw your Kirsten Pedry and Margot Alvarez were actually your first two to the bar in the second round. And your leader that had come in after the first one, it was actually Reagan Huckabee, where she had 24 reps. She only got 9 on the last one. I'd be curious to see who gets off the ski erg first between Kirsten Pedry and Anna Tobias. They were first off there behind Margot Alvarez in the second heat. And it looks like it's going to be Margot Alvarez again. Fabe, so your lanes 1, 2, and 3, they're faster on the front half of each section here.
They're 1, 2, 3 off the skier, 1, 2, 3 in the rep count, as Margot Alvarez is now tied with Anna Tobias. Tobias in the middle, Pedri on the left, Alvarez on the far right side of the screen. They're all working towards rep number 45. This is the farthest we've seen anybody get in the first three rounds of this event. There's still one interval remaining, which will hit in 5 seconds. We'll have the 1 minute transition period before starting that last round. And Anna Tobias will have the lead. Apologies for the scoring issue we're having there at the top, but it is Anna Tobias out in front as she's through 51 overhead squats.
And she's doing a great job of getting out early and giving herself as much time as possible on the bar. And she hasn't had any issues so far. Now, what the next challenge is going to be is that we've only had 2 minutes to get as many overhead squats. As we move into this final round, they're going to get 3 minutes. So some of these athletes who only had about 45 seconds, maybe 30 seconds on the bar, had the ability to keep it up overhead for that time frame. Throw another minute on there, and then you're going to need to see if one some athletes will take breaks on purpose. The last thing you want to do is fail in overhead squats because you blew out your arms and able to hold that. Take a very structured break towards the end of this.
Interval four underway. It's the only one that is 3 minutes long as we're working to the 12-minute time cap.
This fourth round is when we see most athletes start to really struggle on these rope climbs. It's the overhead squat. So in the first half, you see this part being the difference maker and who gets to the bar first. And as you get to the later rounds, it's actually the overhead squats that starts hurting the first part of this event.
Alvarez, Pedri, Tobias. Top three in the overhead squats. They're the first three to the ski erg, along with Alethea Boone.
And what we've seen is that Boone has matched up with Margot Alvarez always early in the first part of the ski erg, but Alvarez is always one of the first ones to get off. She has a bit stronger strokes than Alethea Boone does. She has very short, very choppy. You don't want to get too short on a ski erg, especially for something like seven cows. And what you want to do is put more of your body into the stroke than your arms, because you're going to need your legs and your shoulders, especially when you have about a minute and 45 seconds to do some overhead squats.
Plenty of time to see perhaps our first finisher of this event as they race to rep number 75. Kirsten Pedri now out in front as she's pulled ahead of Anna Tobias. A little bit quicker of a transition getting to the overhead squats, and they're now in a synchronization tie for the lead. Pedri in lane number one on the very top of the screen. Tobias in the pink shorts in lane number two. Pedri needed a moment to collect herself coming out of the bottom of an overhead squat. It gives Tobias a slight lead by a rep and a half over Kristen Pedri. And Anna Tobias is through rep number 66. There's nine reps to go, three segments of the floor. Five final reps for Anna Tobias. Mostly known for her work in endurance events. Gonna have to put her name up there in terms of how they can do in interval events as well. She'll be our first finisher here in event number 12.
I've got to pick my jaw up off the floor about how long both of these athletes held that bar up overhead for those final over 20 reps on the final round.
Alethea Boone is about six reps away with 12 seconds remaining. She's moved ahead of Margot Alvarez. Boone has had this bar up over her head for over a minute now and unable to hang on anymore, and she'll be three reps shy of finishing this event. But we do have our first two finishers here in event number 12. The 2-2-2-3 interval has two finishers in heat number two, led by Anna Tobias at 11:26.
Anna Tobias in the pink and blue held that bar over her head for over 25 consecutive repetitions in the final round of this event. That was one of the more impressive things I've seen her do all weekend, because that is a hard position to hold for that amount of time. Just think about holding your arms over your head for 90 seconds. Now put 105 pounds overhead. Anna Tobias, what a performance of her.
halfway point in women's event number 12. Two heats down, two heats remain as it's time for heat number three of the 2-2-2-3 intervals. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Amanda Krenz with you here in Madison, Wisconsin. And the fourth day of competition, we've seen a little separation in the point standings. We could see a little bit of separation here in this event as well.
Well, it'd be easy to just say do 75 overhead squats for time at 105, but they have to do it in 2-minute intervals with a 1-minute break and a final 3-minute interval. Oh yeah, every round starting with 2 rope climbs and 7 cals on that skier just to get to your barbell.
Whether it be on social media or on the games floor, Dave Castro always has a special message for the athletes. For more there, we go to Amanda Krenz.
When Dave Castro starts off his event announcement with an apology, you know it's not going to be a good thing. He said he was sorry to the athletes, not the actual athletes, but their legs, because they're going to have to do some more squatting, a lot of squatting in this event. These athletes are having a lot of leg fatigue right now at this point in the competition, but these are incredibly fit people, the fittest in the world. We'll see if that muscle fatigue slows them down whatsoever.
Thank you, Amanda. Here in heat number three, there's some good rope climbers. We'll see how they handle the overhead squats, but I know somebody you're looking at is somebody that normally gets a little overlooked in these kind of events, Christy Aramo in lane number 6.
Well, what her specialty is that she's very good at pretty much everything across the board. She has some holes here and there, but she's a good mover. I think that the best movers will do the best in this event. Now, you said rope climbs. China Cho, right off the bat, especially when you're throwing in just classic regular rope climbs. She has set one of the fastest times in the world when it comes to Tommy V, which had 21 total rope climbs in it. China Cho can climb some ropes.
Four intervals of work. Three of them are 2 minutes long. The last one is 3. They'll all start with this buy-in. 2 rope climbs all the way to the top of that giant A-frame rig on the middle of the floor. 20 feet on the way up, 20 feet on the way down.
In this first 2-minute interval, you want to see athletes get out of the gates quick. You're fresh. This will be the only time the rope climbs feel this easy.
And there we go with Christy Aramo first off the rope climbs. China Cho second off the rope climbs. And then 4 athletes right there with them getting to the skier. Implement. Not many affiliates have them. I would say that probably 1 out of 5 might have these ski ergs. They're still getting a little bit more popular, but they are a fatiguer getting to this portion. 105 pounds going up for 75 overhead squats.
It's actually Danny Horan who was off the ski erg first. Aramo and Cho just behind her, but what she was doing is a pretty interesting technique. She had very short, choppy strokes, but China Cho, look how narrow that grip is. That's exactly what you want to see, because if you have the functional flexibility to bring your hands in, it's less about having a wide grip for stability. That's a narrow grip too for Christy Aramo. That allows you to stabilize the bar more. Now, what it challenges is your flexibility. Those athletes that can bring their grip in and still keep a good position are those that will be able to take big chunks out of these overhead squats, not just now, but towards the end.
Final 10 seconds in interval number 1 as we work to the 2-minute mark. Danny Horan out in front. She stands up rep number 26 to close the opening round. That's the most we've seen from anybody in the first 2-minute interval.
The closest we've seen so far is 2 athletes that hit 24 repetitions. And what Horan did is that she got to the bar ahead of everyone else after the rope climbs and skiered, where she made up most of her time. And so I said, there's 2 ways to get more reps. You give yourself more time, or you do bigger sets quicker. In the beginning, you want to try to give yourself more time. You don't want to blow up too quick. In this next round, I'd like to see him be a little bit more conservative. You do have plenty more rounds left to go to get those 75 total.
15 seconds remains until we start round number 2. It's once again the same thing we saw on the first time. 2 rope climbs, 7 calories on the ski erg, and then as many overhead squats as you can get until that 5-minute mark.
see Dani Horan in the fore part of your screen. What she does very well is she takes big chunks out of this 20-foot rope. And what we've seen a lot over the years is that athletes will jump and bring their knees and bring their feet and heels as high as they can to limit how many actual pulls they'll have to tax their arms with. But Chrissy Aramo, they're in lane number six, first off the rope, just alongside China Cho, left side in the blue. So top two and round one coming off the ropes are the same in this event.
All 10 athletes onto the ski erg for 7 calories. Aramo on the right, Cho on the left. They come into this portion of the event with Aramo in fifth place, 5 reps behind Dani Horan. China Cho, 3 reps behind Horan, who is the leader, as noted by her name being in blue, indicating that she is out in front. Everybody else will be in red, the minus number showing how many reps they are behind the lead.
In the first round, China Cho was second off the ski erg behind Dani Horan. She's up at the top part of your screen in lane number two. She was first off the ski erg, and Dani Horan is just getting to her bar, so Horan might have gone out a little too fast on the first round with those 26 repetitions.
30 seconds left in interval number two. Cho will drop the bar after rep number 33, but one thing I noticed that I like is how comfortable her facial expression is. She just looks nice and relaxed at this point of the event.
This should be a relaxing movement. This is not like the 90 thrusters these athletes had to do yesterday. That's a very taxing movement just because the bar is sitting on the front part of your chest. If you can have a good position overhead, overhead squats for high volume is probably the most enjoyable one if you can get in good positions. Now, if you can't, I think more people are on the boat of max reps of overhead squats is zero fun.
First time all day after two intervals, we've got people in the 40s. That includes Cassidy Lance McQuarter, who's at 41. China Cho also at 41. Alessandra Pacelli, 1 rep back at 40.
And these athletes were about 25 reps and 24 reps in the first round, so they got 15 to 16 into the second.
And for an update during this rest period, let's go down to the floor and Amanda Krenz.
A rest period like this feels really nice to these athletes. On one hand, you get that chance to recover. The rest is so nice. But there's another way that some athletes are looking at this. Sometimes they get into their head a little bit in moments like this. They start looking up at the Jumbotron. They look around at the other athletes and where their competitors' barbells are on the floor. They try not to overthink things during this time. Now, here's something to take note of on the ropes. You're going to see the black piece of tape around the middle of the rope there, about halfway up, maybe a little over halfway up. On their way back down the rope, the athletes have to make sure their hands are on that rope below that tape mark before they can let themselves fly off. Now, that's still quite a ways up there. We've seen athletes, for the most part, hanging onto that rope quite a ways below that tape before they actually fall down to the mat.
And everybody being good on getting underneath that black line in round number three as we work towards the 8-minute overall time mark. And Cassidy Lance McQuarter in blue and yellow on the third lane from the left, quickly to the ski erg as she sits tied for the lead coming into this round with China Cho.
And China Cho was off the ropes into the ski erg nearly at the same time as Cassidy Lance. So your two leaders coming in by just 1 rep over Alessandra Pacelli. So let's not forget about her as we move into this third round. They have about 50 seconds, but China Cho just outside your screens off the ski erg and onto her barbell.
Pacelli will be the sixth to leave the ski erg as Cho is already onto the barbell, something that hurt Cassidy Lance McQuarter, who's just now making her way to the bar. She had to do a triple take on that final calorie. She thought she had it, nearly let go of the handles, and had to do 2 more pulls before she got that last calorie.
How deep they are into their total of 75 as China Cho is slowly approaching the 50 rep mark as she will drop the bar. With just 20 seconds left, I said be conservative in round two. In round three, get as far as you can. I don't even care if you start to failing on these reps, because what you want to do is to leave as few reps as possible at the final round of this event.
Final 5 seconds. We've only had 2 finishers in this event through the first 2 heats. And I would say there's five athletes well within position of joining them as China Cho back out in front. And she did so with a quick work in the buy-in portion of this round.
I like how calm she looks walking back to the start. But China Cho, who came off the ropes in line with Cassidy Lance McWhorter, look how big those strokes are. And I tell you what, that's where the swimming background comes into play, as China Cho did that in college, is that you're very proficient with that sweeping movement, knowing how to maximize the length of your pull versus the speed of your pull.
Nice recovery by Cassidy Lance McWhorter, who is sixth or seventh getting to the barbell. She still stays just one rep behind the leader, China Cho. Fourth and final 3-minute window this time. And in this lead battle, where's it going to be determined?
Well, between Cassidy Lance McWhorter and China Cho, she's going to have to go fast on the ropes. They were about the same time, but China blew her out of the water on the ski erg. So Cassidy, and it's not like you really have to beg her to do this, she has to become aggressive. She's going to have to get to the bar before China Cho. Now, China did break one time in that third set where Cassidy had the bar overhead the entire time, but it's about getting to the bar first and just, do you have the ability to hang on for those last 20 to 19 overhead squats?
First off the rope climbs is China Cho. Second will be Christy Aramo, who continues to hang around that lead battle, five reps back. Alessandra Pacelli will be third. Turi Helgadottir fourth. Whoa, Emily Abbott just came crashing down on that crash pad, but she did get the rep, and she was controlled, at least below the black line.
China Cho, those long, sweeping pulls, and what she's not doing is using her legs too much. Watch her drive her chest down and use more of her lats to help pull as opposed to just her arms to do the work.
This will be the fewest amount of reps needed to finish this event in the final round. 11 minutes, 26.81 seconds is the time to beat. China Cho needs 19 reps and a little over a minute to do so, as Alessandra Pacelli is making her way to the bar, but losing touch with China Cho's lead. It's now a 6-rep differential. Make it 7 before Pacelli gets her first rep. Cho on the left side of the screen is all by herself in the battle for the lead, 10 reps away. Alessandra Pacelli gets a no rep. That brings Cassidy Lance McWhorter and Turi Helgadottir in line with her in the race for second. But China Cho has 6 reps remaining and nearly 40 seconds left to beat the time of Anna Tobias from heat number 2. Shoulders starting to fade, still a minute until the time cap, 22 seconds left until the time to beat.
We've seen before, you gotta be careful at the positioning when you're trying to sprint towards the end, because that bar can come down in a hurry.
And this time she can set it down. China Cho, new time to beat at 11 minutes, 15.91 seconds. Great race for second, and Alessandra Pacelli went around the bar instead of over the bar. She'll still hang on to second for the heat and second in the event. Cassidy Lance McWhorter third in the heat, fourth in the event. Turi Helgadottir fourth in the heat, fifth in the event. Brooke Wells will be our fifth finisher, and Alessandra Pacelli actually going to get credit for 11:28, so she'll lose a couple of positions, one in the heat, two overall in the event, because of the mistake she made going over the bar. Dani Horan, our early leader, she had more reps on that opening round than anybody we've seen thus far, and it came back to bite her in the end.
Well, I think it's one of those things, is that there's so many different rounds and elements to this specific event, is that you don't really want to come out. It's like coming off the assault runner first in a long chipper. You don't want to be the first one to get close to those overhead squats, but China Cho was okay with being first. She was fast off the rope climb, fast on the ski erg, and her positioning on the overhead squats was so good. She had that more narrow grip, and that allows you to do more reps under fatigue. China Cho banking on what she's good at, rope climbs, that ski erg, good position on overhead squats.
So China Cho leading the way with one heat remaining at 11:15.91 seconds with heat 4 next. It has been a crazy weekend here in Madison, Wisconsin in the women's race at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. The next test to see if we can sort out the point standings is here with the 2-2-2-3 intervals. For the first time all weekend, Tia Claire Toomey has actually put herself a little bit ahead. She's got some breathing room over fellow countrywoman Cara Webb. It's a 38-point lead for Toomey over Webb coming into this test.
And here we have an interval-style event. We haven't seen this for a long time at the CrossFit Games, and not since around 2011, 2012, where we've dedicated some time for the athletes to work. Two rope climbs 20 feet high, followed by a 7-cal skier, but the race is on the bar. 75 overhead squats for time at 105 pounds.
Sometimes part of the fun of an event comes in the announcement of it. For more There We Go to Amanda Krenz.
And this particular announcement also came with an apology from Games Director Dave Castro, not necessarily saying sorry to the athletes, but to their legs, because they were going to have to do a lot more squatting. These athletes are definitely experiencing some leg fatigue after all the squatting they've done throughout this competition. We'll see if it has any sort of impact on this event, guys.
Thank you, Amanda. Here in heat number 4, it's our top 10 in the point standings coming into this event. And the points leader, Tia Claire Toomey, she is efficient with a barbell, but can she hang on to that points lead here in this one?
Well, she's going to have to hang on to that and hang on to this rope with that 20-foot climb. Tia Claire has the overall lead, but the athletes chasing her are no slouches either, and sometimes it's a lot easier to chase than be chased, so Tia has to look over her shoulders.
The chase is also on for the third and final podium position at this point in the competition. That currently held by Tennille Reed on the left, Annie Thorisdottir just 12 points back on the right.
As we get into this event, Annie Thorisdottir is good at rope climbs and apparently a master on the skier, as Brooke Entz was talking about earlier. But I really like Tennille Reed's tenacity to have her on the rope. She's going to be good on the climbs, fine on the skier. And if you've ever noticed throughout the weekend, is that she has a more narrow grip on overhead squatting movements. That could play into her favor as we get deeper into this event.
As far as normal events go, this one a little bit awkward because of the structure. What are you looking at and how this could play out?
Well, we have multiple rounds. It's almost like a prize fight. You got 2 minutes on and a minute break. You need to be able to adapt on the fly as things change throughout this event. The other one is knowing when to go, and that's when to push. You want to push early and hard in event number 1, but don't go to failure. In event number 2, or round 2, you don't want to go too hard. Save a little bit of tank for that third round to set yourself up for the fourth.
1, 2, 3 off the skier. It's daughter, daughter, and daughter. Katrin David's daughter in first. Annie Thorisdottir in second. Sarah Sigmund's daughter in third. And your points leader, Tia Claire Toomey, is 9th to the bar. But she's okay because Cara Webb was 10th to the bar.
And I like to see David's daughter coming out so aggressively. She is well down the leaderboard when it comes to having another shot at repeating, but there's still opportunities to maybe crack the top 3, but she has to win events if she wants a chance to do so.
David's daughter, the first one beyond the 20 mark on the floor, now working towards rep 30. They'll advance the bar every 10 reps within the first set of 30. Beyond that, they'll advance it every 3 reps. Cara Webb last to the barbell, but she has passed her points rival, Tia Claire Toomey. Webb in blue, Toomey in the white leader's jersey. As Katrin David's daughter, we were saying nobody got through 25 reps in the opening interval thus far. David's daughter taking a shot at it, going for 31 in round number 1.
That is a big gamble when it comes to how many reps they just put in there. But they were one of the 2 fastest through the rope, and especially off the skier. And that's what we need to see from your former champs, both Annie Thorisdottir and David's daughter side by side, is come out swinging. This is the final day. You have minimal opportunities left to get up in that top 3.
30 seconds left in the first rest period before we start our second 2-minute interval. And Katrin David's daughter, 31 reps. Annie Thorisdottir, 2 reps behind. Sarah Sigmund's daughter, 2 reps behind her as they sit 6th, 4th, and 5th in the point standings, respectively. And for Katrin, 144 points out of the lead. She's 60 points out of a podium spot. At this point, it's risk versus reward.
I mean, at this point, like I said, is that you might as well go down swinging. You don't want to lay down ever in competition, especially if you're a two-time defending CrossFit Games champion. But we didn't say Toomey's name too much in the first round, yet she still got over 22 reps in that first set of 2 minutes.
Quick transition on the rope climbs from rep one to rep two for Toomey. She'll be easy to spot, the only one in that white and red leader's jersey. And Carl Webb, the slowest on these two rope climbs in all blue. She made it work for her in round number one, but she could only flirt with that line too many times, so she had to make a double take to get that touch on top of that giant A-frame rig.
Well, she might have some of the best overhead squats relative to this heat, but you have to give yourself an opportunity to utilize the skills at which you're good at. You need to be able to move through the rope climbs fast, get through the skier without blowing yourself up too much, and then hit those overhead squats as fast as you can.
Same thing, different interval. Three daughters out in front, Carrie Pierce right there with them. Katrin David's daughter just ahead of Annie Thoris' daughter. It's Katrin in the yellow sports bra, yellow tank top for Thoris' daughter. They're first and second with Sarah Sigmund's daughter on the opposite end of the floor, just one rep back. There's a look at Sarah on the left side of the screen.
I like this savvy move. If you saw in the right box, Annie Thoris' daughter, who's just to the left of Katrin David's daughter, actually put the bar on her shoulders to advance forward and did a snatch balance into her first rep. Look at it, dropping it on the shoulders, and then she'll drop into the next repetition. That could save you towards the end of this event.
Your top three in overhead squat totals are fourth, fifth, and sixth in the point standings. Third place, Tennille Reed Berline, is lagging back in this heat in eighth place at 39 reps, as is also the case for Tia Claire Toomey at 39 points. But Tennille Reed on a magnificent second year here at the Games, trying to hang on to that third position in the point standings, only 14 points ahead of Annie.
But she's kind of slow on the ropes. What is kind of funny is how we've gotten to this point in heat number four where we thought 39 reps was not a very good place to be in. Well, when you have six other people, seven athletes get 40 or more, we didn't even see those totals after three sets.
So Katrin David's daughter leading the way once again by two reps over Annie Thoris' daughter, who's two reps ahead of Sarah Sigmund's daughter. They just bumped up the rep count. The intervals remain the same for our top three as we're 15 seconds away from interval number three. And Katrin, she's doing what she needs to do to make that push up the leaderboard late here in the competition, but Annie Thoris' daughter and Sarah Sigmund's daughter aren't giving her a whole lot of help.
This third round, you need to sell out, especially if you're in the position of Katrin David's daughter. For Sigmund's daughter and Thor's daughter, you need to take a little bit of a gamble, because what you want to do is to get as far as you possibly can, even towards the idea of failing towards the end. But you want to make sure you set yourself up for the last round. Toomey is actually sitting in ninth place in this heat currently. There's other athletes that's actually done a little bit better than her in the previous three heats based off her current standing.
It's still an all Iceland top three coming out of the rope climbs, but there's more athletes that are making their way in terms of cutting that interval from the rope climbs to the skier. Tennille Reed was one of them. Carrie Pierce, another one of those athletes as well.
Now, Toomey might be in ninth in this heat, but she's only four repetitions out of fourth. Shows you how tight it's on top.
It's a run to the bar this time for Katrin David's daughter, who will get there first, trying to gain on that lead interval over Annie Thoris' daughter, who just goes straight into a snatch on that first rep. She did catch it below parallel and stood it up. That's a good overhead squat.
And Katrin David's daughter has that narrow grip I was talking about, in exact opposite just to her left. Annie Thoris' daughter has a naturally wide grip. In the left box, Sarah Sigmund's daughter as well. This is where Katrin can have an advantage towards the more fatigued parts of this round.
Keep an eye on the center of the screen. Carl Webb is going for that three rep then drop it on the shoulders into a snatch balance strategy, and she is gaining ground on the rest of the field, just 8 reps behind Davidsdottir in the final few seconds in our third interval, and Katrin Davidsdottir nearly pulled off what Dave Castro said would be impossible, getting 75 reps in the first 3 intervals.
She is 7 reps away from hitting 75. And my only question is that why is this happening in event number 12? Why haven't we seen this for 11 other events?
So as Katrin has been leading since the beginning, Kara Webb is making a push late. She's at rep number 60 after 3 intervals.
I like the transition for Kara Webb, putting it on her shoulders, advancing forward. That saves you enough time or enough energy and strength in your shoulders to keep the pace quick. So Kara made up a lot of ground on that third round.
The one that got hurt the most in that interval, Sarah Sigmundsdottir, going from third to fifth, but she's only 1 rep behind that tie for third. And our final interval underway. The only difference, this one is 3 minutes, but I don't believe anybody in the top 5 in terms of our overhead squats are going to need that amount of time.
Katrin Davidsdottir has only 7 squats left to hit the 75 mark. What I want to see with this amount of reps is just go for it. Sell out on the rope. Annihilate yourself on the ski yard and get to the finish line. You have to have first place finishes from here on out.
First and second are the only 2-time female champions in games history. They're second and third to the skier. It's Carrie Pierce leading the way out of the rope climbs. She's in sixth, only 11 reps behind Davidsdottir in the lead. Davidsdottir, Thorisdottir, right and left of the screen. 5 reps separate the two as they battle for the lead. Kara Webb has made the biggest push as of late since the slow start to round number 1. And here comes Katrin running side by side with Carrie Pierce on the inside lane.
I want to see her snatch this first rep right off the floor.
She'll go very steady through it as Kara Webb makes her way to the bar at the same time as Tia Claire Toomey. Big point implications as she has a head start on Toomey as we start this round for them, but we close the round for Katrin Davidsdottir. You've been asking for it all weekend. Where's the Katrin we saw in 2015 and 2016? We see her again in event number 12. Points, points, points is all that matters right now. Annie Thorisdottir to second. Sarah Sigmundsdottir right behind, but it's Kara Webb.
That's not right. She was in the 72 box. I don't know if the judge just didn't move her forward. I'll have to see what the total rep was, but I don't think she finished her last 3 unless the judge told her that she didn't have to advance into that last box.
Something is amiss here, and it could have major implications. Tia Claire Toomey still on the floor. She is ahead of both Sam Briggs in lane number 1 and Tennille Reed Burline in the background of the screen is in dead last as first and third in the point standings are taking significant hits right now in event number 12. Tia Claire Toomey, points leader, 8th in the heat. Give her 14th in the event, and if these results stand, that would be 94 points for Webb, 52 points for Tia Claire Toomey, and Kara Webb might be atop the point standings, though that is unofficial.
That's a 42-point differential between the two finishing places.
We're going to work out what happened there and the finish for second, but what we do know is Katrin Davidsdottir gets her second win of the weekend and her 6th event win of her career. But Kara Webb, this could be gigantic.
Well, this is the question that I have just from watching from my vantage point. Look at the bottom right part of the box. Kara Webb was doing her final set of overhead squats in the 72 section. Now, what may have happened, because we don't know officially, is that the judge might have not just had her advance, but she could have completed the total of 75 reps, but in the 72.
It is a big, big question that's going to have to be answered as we try to sort out the point standings. Here's another look.
Cara Webb drops the bar, runs over to the finish line. Look at her judge. He's sitting on the 75 mark where Annie Thorisott are just below. We're doing their final squats. They're supposed to do their last three squats in the 75 section. Now, what they're going to have to do is they're going to have to go back and count the total number of repetitions to confirm that she did 75 total overhead squats. Now, I know she wasn't doing them in the 72. It could just have been a judge positioning error. Hopefully, it's not a judge counting error.
Now, if it is a counting error, they will have ways to sort that out. But it does make a big difference in terms of the placing as she came in just ahead of Annie Thorisdottir and Kristen Holta, who moved into the fourth position by only 4 seconds as it stands right now, and the point implications could not be any bigger. But as that gets sorted out, how about the performance that we haven't seen this all weekend from Katrin Davidsdottir?
Well, what we saw is that she was hundreds plus points out of contention to repeat. But winning this event and having other athletes not do as well, she's actually kind of put herself closer to contention to podium.
Katrin, you needed an event win. What was your mindset coming into this event?
Right before one on the floor, Ben said we compete with excellence, and that just means that I have to give it everything that I have every single round with no effect of my surroundings. So I just kept going for it.
What are your thoughts on this competition so far and how you've done?
Oh my gosh, it's been a blast. These events have been amazing. I'm happy there's been highs, there's been lows, some disappointments, but that's always, sometimes you gotta take risks, sometimes they pay off, sometimes they don't. So overall, I'm happy.
This competition is not over yet, so what are you gonna focus on for the remainder of the 2017 CrossFit Games?
I'm just gonna keep giving it hell.
Good luck.
Katrin Davidsdottir, this one we know. She has 100 points for the event. What we don't know is how many points Cara Webb will get because of a controversial finish.
72. See, she's standing in the 72 mark. That means she has to do reps 70, 71, and 72. There's the red 75 that the judge is sitting on. That's where you do reps 73, 74, 75. So what the question is, and we don't know the answer to it yet, is that, was she just in the wrong spot, or did she not do the amount of reps? Now, the judge did tell her to finish. That's the other part of this. So, you know, part of it, they say it all the time, it's on the athletes to know how many they've done and what rep they're at. When you're racing towards the end of this, and what major implications, the implication is who's going to sit in first place after this event. And what they're looking at is they're going to have to look at the total number of reps. And that's what Adrian Bosman, who's in the right box, has been doing for the last several minutes, is counting every single overhead squat that she did based off where she was at on the field.
If the result holds, Cara Webb unofficially would be the points leader. If they revert back after two people would have passed her in what would have reasonably been a time, if they go that route, Tia Toomey would be the points leader unofficially going into the final event. This could not be bigger in terms of how this controversy plays out.
And what it does is that it still is going to create a very close gap at the top. Who sits on top of the leaderboard may change. If it stands, Webb has a 4-point edge on Tia Clarke Toomey, not knowing what or if we have anything left after this on the individual side. If not, she'll be about 6 to 8 points below Tia Clarke Toomey. All, I would say this, controversy aside, is shaping up to be an amazing finish to this Games.
Head judge Adrian Bosman been working on this, and as we get information, we'll get that update to you as soon as we can, but we're going to have to transition over to the men's side of event number 12, but Cara Webb or Tia Clarke Toomey, one way or another, an Australian's leading the way as we come out of event number 12 on the women's side. And we do have an update from the floor. Let's go to Amanda Krenz.
I do this first.
You guys, when Dave Castro announced this event, he made an apology to the athletes first and foremost because he said, "I'm sorry about your legs, guys."
It'd be like two places.
But what just happened on the floor right now is what we are going to focus on. The judges are having conversations about Kara Webb and her lane. It appears that her judge let her finish before she was done with all of her overhead squat reps. She had 3 reps left to do, but she was allowed to cross the finish line. This is something that the judges are still confirming, so we'll definitely keep you guys posted.
As we get the information, we will try to figure out and let you know what's going on the women's side of competition, but the men's side is next. Event number 12 is here for the men's side of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games at the Alliant Energy Center, and it's their turn for the 2-2-2-3 intervals. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Sam Farber with you here in Madison, Wisconsin. And we can set aside what happened on the women's side just for a moment here as we get ready for the men to take the floor.
And they're going to be tackling the same style of event. They'll have 4 intervals to work within. The first 3, 2 minutes, the last 3 minutes. Every round will start with 2 rope climbs at 20 feet, followed by 10 cals on the skiers. The race is at the barbell. 75 overhead squats for time at 155 pounds.
It's a heavy bar. They'll have those 4 intervals, and our first athletes to take on this 4 interval challenge are a field of 9 here in heat number 1. And there's some good names in it, but somebody you got your eye on is in lane number 5, Jason Carroll.
Well, I mean, this guy came out and just is playing to the crowd all weekend long. He just got engaged on the floor. I like the way he's been competing. And a man who is no stranger to overhead squats, Elijah Muhammad, has such good positioning and strong legs. And, oh, by the way, he could probably jump halfway up the rope if he wanted to. I like this event for Elijah Muhammad.
Underway with the first of 3 2-minute intervals out of 4 total intervals in this event. It's still the same 2 rope climbs to the 20-foot mark that we saw on the women's side, but the one difference on the buy-in portion, it's 10 calories on the skier.
No surprise off the start, Elijah Muhammad making very quick work of these rope climbs. Alex Smith next to him on the left is done with his rope climbs as well. So your top 2 right next to each other in lanes 2 and 3.
At the 2-minute mark, we'll have that 1-minute rest period, and we'll start seeing people come to the barbells in a few seconds. The judge's hand will go up indicating the final 5 calories, and that is the case for Elijah Muhammad and Alex Smith.
And what we saw in the final heat of the women is that Katrin Davis' daughter just went for it. I think that might be the way to play this, especially if you're in the first heat. Just get as far as you can in the first round without getting sloppy. See how many reps you can put in the bank in these first 2 minutes.
Holden Rethwill, the first to the barbell. He has a slight lead of about a half a rep over Elijah Muhammad on the right. Alex Smith also in the mix on the left. But it's Elijah Muhammad's name in blue as he is the current leader. And it's now Zeke Grove out in front. You'll notice the leader's name will always be in blue. Everybody else will be in red, the minus number showing how many reps they are behind the lead.
Zeke Grove in the 4 part of your screen moved up at the same time as Elijah Muhammad. Elijah Muhammad's all the way up in lane number 3 in all blue. I like this transition from 10 to 20 where he finished his last rep, rested it on his shoulders, and then advanced into the next section.
Final 10 seconds until the 1-minute rest. And about half the field actually stopping shy of the 2-minute mark. And as we start with the men's side, we want to clarify some things that happened on the women's heat number 4. For that, we go to Sam Farber.
Okay, guys, so the report is Kara Webb only did 72 reps. They have added 6 seconds to her time. So she does get credit for finishing the event. They have added 6 seconds to her time. They will retabulate the final results. But again, it was a inadvertent advancement for her not doing the full 75 reps, so she has 6 seconds added on that last event.
And it was kind of hard to hear. You could hear Dave Castro talking to him, and it's what, you know, they wanted to look at the total repetitions that she did. They found out it was 72. Well, what's the next step you need to take? Exactly that. What they did was they timed her section previous to that and how long it took her to do 3 overhead squats. 6 seconds was the time, so that's the time they added to Cara Webb's overall finishing.
And that's not an unprecedented thing. It did happen in an event last year, 100%, where they had somebody in that won the event. They had to retabulate things after a judging error, so there is precedent to that. But what we do know is Cara Webb will actually be in second place in the point standings because of that error. So back to the men's action in heat number 1 of event number 12. Zeke Grove led the way after the first interval at 23 overhead squats, but he had Holden Rethwill, Josh Bridges, and Jeff Patzer 1 rep back, Elijah Muhammad 2 reps back as they all make their way to the ski erg for the second round of the buy-in.
Still, your goal here is to move as fast as you can through this first portion of the 20-foot rope climbs and 10 cals on the skier without sacrificing too much of your shoulder strength and stability. You're going to need those shoulders and need those legs, not just to squat through this, but to stabilize the bar in that position.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel like the pacing here on the men's heat one is a lot more relaxed, a lot more conservative than we saw from any of the women's heats that happened in the past hour.
Well, say at least the first heat on the women's side was conservative like this. They weren't sure how to approach this. If I were sitting in the back and I saw what those women did in the final heat where they were just out there with reckless abandon, I mean, if you're in heat one, now's the time to really just get out there and go for it. Nothing's going to really change for your positioning on the leaderboard, but you can still go out there and put on a show.
It's one thing to always consider. There is prize money for event wins. It's $3,000 for first, $2,000 for second, $1,000 for third. Always helps to have a little extra motivation there. And Elijah Muhammad is one of a few athletes that continues to drop the bar with a few seconds remaining. And as we had that update on the women's results in event number 12 that did change the women's points leaderboard after event number 12. And your updated look at things, Tia Toomey does hold on to the points lead, 6 points clear of Cara Webb. Annie Thorisdottir, 56 points back. She's just ahead of Sarah Sigmundsdottir and Katrin Davidsdottir for the third and final provisional position on the podium. And for a further update, we go to Sam Farber.
Yeah, guys, I just spoke with Dave Castro, director here at the Reebok CrossFit Games. He is the one who told Cara Webb that it would be 6 seconds added to her time, and he said that she was okay with it. She's all right with it. That's the report, and that's the shakeup now, as you just mentioned, to the leaderboard.
Thank you, Sam. And honestly, when Cara went to the platform, she almost had a look of like, they told me to go. It didn't look like she was doing that intentionally. She was just told to go and reacted in time.
I tell you what, if I'm racing at the end and I'm not really sure exactly where I'm at and they tell me to go, I'm getting out of there as fast as I can, so I don't blame her.
So as we start the third 2-minute interval, Jeff Patzer finds himself in the lead. But by just 1 rep over Josh Bridges, who's nearly completely on the other end of the floor from him. Patzer and Alex Smith will be the first 2 to the ski erg for the 3rd time in this event.
I think Elijah Muhammad might have actually gotten a no rep on one of his rope climbs, or maybe his grip's just going out. I wasn't paying enough attention to see. I just thought he was going up and down with Alex Smith.
Well, Elijah Muhammad will be last to the ski erg, the 3rd man to the ski erg, Josh Bridges. And man, what a difference he's had in the past few events from what we've seen at the start.
Yes, he did. Had a great finish to the evening last night in the heavy 17.5. Not as much this morning with the hay bales or straw bales. I've heard that the correct term is straw bales. But if you look back to the games, if you want to think, where can you look to see who's going to be successful? Josh Bridges can do overhead squats pretty much for days, because we had that Naughty Nancy event at the Games a few years ago where it had 25 overhead squats after runs at this weight. He did every single round unbroken.
Final 10 seconds until our last 1 minute rest period. Josh Bridge is advancing beyond rep number 48, but he's still behind Jeff Patzer at the top of the screen in yellow and purple, who is through 51 reps with one round remaining. And Elijah Muhammad finding himself in eighth place in the heat at 37 squats. And it came from the rope climbs that gave him the trouble.
Yeah, and that's very surprising to see, but you know, sometimes you're at the mercy of your grip. And if you don't have that, or you say you lose your footing, and one thing you got to be careful of is that one little slip or misstep, you mess your hands up on one of these climbs, that can be detrimental. But he got the two climbs in, but I think he dropped too soon. Amanda was talking about, where he's touching, but there's a lot of important things. Where you touch the rope and where you drop from the rope. If you touch it in the wrong spot or you drop too high, you're going to lose that rep.
Our final interval underway. This the lone 3 minute interval. It's Jeff Patzer, the closest to reaching that final rep number 75. In lane number one in yellow and purple, he's the leader coming into this last round.
And just to show you how much that hurt Elijah Muhammad, he went from one of the top positions to the very bottom in eighth place. And that's not the first time we've seen rope climbs hurt Elijah Muhammad, who's sitting in number three. This guy missed the CrossFit Games last year on a rope climb at the South Regional a year ago.
Made two very deliberate touches that time, making sure he did not get a no rep. But because of that deliberate pace, he'll be the last one to the ski erg. One of the first ones to the ski erg is one of the smallest men in the entire field, Jeff Patzer, the rookie out of California. One thing that Jeff Patzer might not get enough credit for, he's one of a handful of athletes, male or female, in the entire field that holds a full-time job while being a games athlete. He's a computer programmer out in California. But first to the bar in lane number five will be Jason Carroll. Had a strong showing in heat number one earlier today in the Madison triplet. So he's trying to close that gap on Patzer. He picks up four reps before Patzer gets on the bar.
Now Carroll's been fast in the beginning section, but it's Patzer on the left and Bridges on the right that have been passing him with ease on the overhead squats. And look how comfortable Josh Bridges looks in that overhead position as he walks forward with the bar above him. I like what Patzer's doing, is he's giving himself a little bit of a break. He puts the bar on his shoulders, steps forward, and does a snatch balance into it. Now, that is a legal move here on the floor. And what that does is it actually helps give your shoulders a break and put them in a good position underneath.
Less than 1 minute until the 12-minute time cap. On the women's side, we had zero finishers under the 12-minute time cap in heat number one. Jeff Patzer is on his way to changing that note on the men's version of this event, as he has six reps remaining. He's working towards rep 72. Three reps left for Jeff Patzer. And we got ourselves a finisher. Jeff Patzer will reach the platform at 11 minutes and 39 seconds. Love how fired up he was for that one, even though it is heat one, but that's a good moment for somebody that was looking for one.
And it all came down to his transitions. You're going to advance every three reps when you get to the last 45 reps of this event. And just to walk with the bar, I think, is an unnecessary position to be in because it just makes you more fatigued. Put it on your shoulders, snatch balance into the first rep. I really like what Patzer did.
Josh Bridges was the closest to finishing at three reps away, but Jeff Patzer, our one finisher here in heat number one.
Every transition, rest the bar on your back, pop the hips, move the feet, drop underneath the bar. That gives you a very good lockout in the elbow, and as you start to get fatigued, getting the bar in the best position is what will save your arms towards the end. I like that strategy by Jeff Patzer.
Welcome back for heat number two of men's event number 12 at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games at the Alliant Energy Center. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Sam Farber with you here in Madison, Wisconsin. One heat down, three heats remain, and the 2-2-2-3 interval.
We only had one finish in the previous heat. I'm looking to have a few more. We have 3 2-minute intervals, basically an AMRAP of overhead squats, but they have to get through 2 rope climbs and 10 cals on the skier with a final 3 minutes to try to complete those 75 reps at 155.
Don't sleep on that buy-in portion of every round, especially the rope climbs. For more there, we go to Sam Farber.
Well, this event's definitely going to be one on the overhead squats, but you can lose it on the rope climb. Couple of details there are very important. You can't just touch that buckle where the rope is wrapped around on top. You have to touch the actual support. And on your way back down, you have to drop your hands below the black line and still have some control of the rope. If you don't, it's a no rep, and that could take you from the top 5 to the bottom 5 in a second.
Heat number 2 will look to not have those kind of mistakes that could change the standings in this heat, as we'll have a few athletes that are more known for their Pacific regional prowess, but Rob Forte, 7th trip to the games, he'll be in lane number 9.
Well, I like this event for him just because he's good at longer events that have multiple reps, high skill movements. You got rope climbs and a skier. He's used to this, especially at the games level. What he does to the bar might be a different story. Counterpart with him, James Snewberry. This guy is a workhorse. He can put in the work and he can grind. Now he's sitting in 23rd place, but once you get to this point at the games, it doesn't matter where you are on the leaderboard. Take it to your heat best you can. You only got a few opportunities left.
And away we go with interval number 1 of 4. This is the first of 3 2-minute intervals. They will all start with 2 20-foot rope climbs to the top of that gigantic A-frame Rogue rig, and then 10 calories on the Concept 2 skier. This one is not a surprise. Travis Williams shot out like a cannon early on in those 2 rope climbs.
But did someone say interval work? And I could see it. If Travis Williams was a dog, those ears perked up really quickly when he saw the movements that he had to do with the rope climbs and skier, and then just grunt speed work on the tail end. What he's going to have to make sure he does is don't blow up too early. Because if you can't stabilize those shoulders, you're not going to be able to get bigger chunks towards the end. Done in 50 seconds, that's one of the fastest ones we've seen. But we said, push the overhead squats. We saw the women's final heat do this, led by Catherine Stavis' daughter. But make sure you don't do it sloppy. Have clean reps throughout. That goes for the rope climbs as well. And then in between, play the field while you're resting. Look at where other people are. Know how many reps you've done and how many you have left relative to these sections that we have as we move through. I know this is only the first 2 minutes, but get a big chunk out of here. Just don't do it as to sacrifice your muscle failure going into the multiple rounds that we have left.
30 seconds remaining in the first 2 minute window. Travis Williams, one of a handful of athletes that follow Misfit programming. This is kind of a pitch right down the middle of the plate for that style. As we'll paraphrase it, they do a lot of grind work at the end of the workouts, and this is pretty similar in structure.
And I like the positioning that he's in and the pace at which he's going. He was out fast, but his overhead squats are very controlled. So push the pace in the beginning. But the clean reps, the point that we were touching to, is that you don't want to be wobbling around everywhere. Every misstep you have taxes the shoulders twice as much.
While the athletes take a breather, we'll take one up in the booth and get an update from Sam Farber.
Well, after this event was announced, I went backstage, talked to some of the athletes about whether this is a speed event or a pace event. Most of them said speed. They said that they thought several guys would be able to get through all 75 reps in the first 3 intervals. Right now, only Travis Williams is on that pace with 29 reps. I also asked head judge Adrian Bosman if he thought anyone could do it. He said maybe one. I'll let you guys guess which one that is.
Well, I would like to say it would flow and be Travis Williams, but I think we all know who we're talking about on that one. But Travis Williams ahead of the numerical pace that would be needed to finish this in three rounds. He's at 29 reps. Frederick Agidius at 24. Michael Palumbo rounding out the top three after a first of four intervals.
If he wants to give himself an opportunity, he's going to have to get at least 20 reps in this round, as he's at only 29, so that would give him 49 total, leaving 26 at the end. I would say if you're wanting to do it in three, then you're going to have to push just as hard, if not harder, in this round to give yourself an opportunity to do so.
Checking back in on Rob Forte, sitting in sixth place in the heat. On the near side of the screen, he's through 20. There's three athletes at 20 overhead squats, but Travis Williams, he might be winning this event because of his speed through the buy-in portion.
Well, he's one of those athletes that you know what you're gonna get, and you're gonna get a fast pace early, and someone who's just not a Travis is not afraid to fail. And I mean that from a positive standpoint, because you know, you see some athletes that are super gun shy out there, like, well, I don't want to screw up, and they're too timid. Travis Williams is never worried about falling off a pace or falling flat on his face. Like, this guy will go for it if he has an opportunity to do so. And this interval style event plays to his strengths very well.
Straight into a snatch on that first rep, just like the snatch balance that we saw Jeff Patzer doing earlier in heat number one. It is a legal move as long as he catches it below parallel and stands it up to extension. So Travis Williams is already through the first 30 reps. In the first 30, they advance every 10. Beyond the first 30, they advance every 3. The number on the floor will mark what number they are working towards. So 39 in the books, now working to rep 42 for Williams, whose name is highlighted in blue as the leader. Everybody else in red, that minus number showing how far they are behind Williams, who is in a good position as we close out the second interval.
I said he had to get at least 20, even closer to 25 to give him a shot through this. But what he can do is that if he gets enough in the third round, watch him go into a dead sprint in that fourth round.
Travis Williams leading the way by 9 reps, but how about his speed in the buy-in portion?
Well, he is the fastest guy off the rope. Now watch Travis, he's on the right relative to Palumbo on the left. He grabs and lifts from there. What that does is it allows you a secure grab from that position to lock your feet in. One of the issues with jumping is that you're kind of taking a chance on getting yourself a good hand grab. At the same time, if you jump and that rope flips away from you, that messes up your foot grab. So starting flat-footed and just grabbing and pulling your knees as high as you can is a safer start and more secure for Travis Williams.
Williams leading the way by 9 reps. This is the biggest lead at any interval finish that we've seen from any heat, male or female, as he's ahead of Frederick Agidius by 9. Tim Paulson rounding out the top three, 11 reps back, as we start our third and final 2-minute interval in the 4 total intervals in this event.
Williams in lane number 2 on the left side in gray. He got 29 reps in the first round, 19 reps in the second, as he started this third round of 2 minutes with 48 reps. Now, I don't see him adding 27 reps at the top of his total at this point, but what I want to see is that if you're not going to make it, you might as well sell out now to minimize how many reps you have left. We saw Catherine David's daughter do that in the final. She only had 7 overhead squats to do in the fourth and final interval. This is interval 3. Don't hesitate or don't be shy at this point. You went so hard in the first round. Go for it here in the third.
Judges hand up for Travis Williams and Rob Forte. They're both in their final 5 calories on the skier. 2 calories left for Williams, 2 remain for Forte, and the first man off the skier will once again be Travis Williams for the 3rd consecutive interval.
The only thing I suggest for Travis is if he is starting to feel some of that shoulder fatigue, is do what Jeff Patzer did in the previous heat and drop the bar to your shoulders as you advance down the floor. He's going to have to walk with that down the floor every 3 repetitions. That means 0 actual work is being done. unless you're just not comfortable dropping into that snatch position from the back of your shoulders, I would suggest doing it.
Had to stop himself from doing a fourth rep inside that box next to the number 57, but Williams working beyond rep number 60 already. He still has 10 minutes until we cut off the third interval. It's a huge lead by numbers and a huge lead down the floor at the Alliant Energy Center. Travis Williams is running away with this one after interval number three.
And he had 48 reps after two rounds, 64 there. So he increased, he got 16 in this round. He has 11 more left to do. As he moves into that set of 54, I like where he has that bar position, that nice vertical torso. There's no deviation with his chest in between. And when he got to this round of 57, overhead squats are one of those that you can kind of get in the zone and find a sweet spot and you want to just keep going. Unfortunately, you can only do three in every section. Williams is kind of getting a feel for the bar. You know, when you find a nice spot, you just want to crank out as many as you can without deviating from that.
Travis Williams leading the way by 13 reps over Rob Forte and Frederick Agidius as we start our fourth and final interval. This the 3-minute interval, and Travis Williams does not have a whole lot of work left.
And I don't think I've ever had to suggest this to an athlete like Travis Williams, but don't be shy in the beginning of this, but don't be in a hurry either. We said you need to have an aggressive pace, but clean reps. The last thing you want to see happen is a misstep with your foot grab, you slide down the rope. You mess up your tag at the top, you get a no rep. You drop too early from the top, like we saw with Elijah Muhammad, you get another no rep. So being your final rope climb, the stress of failing on the rope is gone. Get to the ski erg and go. You only have 11 more squats left to do to finish your 75.
The margin of error on the rope climbs is behind him as he is on the ski erg, as is everybody else here in heat number two. Reminder, the time to beat 11 minutes, 39.19 seconds by the only finisher in heat number one, Jeff Patzer.
Like those big pulls, that is just selling out, driving the chest down, using the lats, right underneath the armpits and using the body to do the pull. You got to hang on to those and use your legs, but hey, Rob Forte, where have you been?
Just slowly chipping away at Travis Williams' pace through the buy-in portion, but he's still 13 reps behind Travis Williams. Forte in the blue shorts on the bottom of the screen as Williams makes his way to that 155-pound bar, straight up snatching that first rep. And he's through rep 66 with 3 segments of the floor remaining. 3 down, 6 to go in the final 9 for Travis Williams. And he's definitely one of those home run hitting types. And he got one. He could absolutely crank on this one. Travis Williams, new time to beat, 10:58.
I really like that pace set by Travis Williams. The positioning on the overheads was fantastic. He never looked like he was deviating, that the shoulders were getting tired. Great time by Travis Williams.
Rob Forte is still 10 reps away of finishing this event.
Now, I know I said earlier is you want to put the bar on your shoulders and advance forward, and it might Tim Paulson. That drop might have put Tim Paulson ahead of Rob Forte as we have about 3 guys join up with him, but you got to make sure is that it is a little bit of a gamble when you do that, because you could punch it out in front, so you have to have good technique with that movement as well.
4 men with 5 reps remaining. Samuel Quant leading the way. Quant advancing to the 75 spot on the floor. That red number 75, the final 3 reps. Can Samuel Quant beat the time cap? Can a couple of others do the same as we got 4 men? And the final 3 reps, Samuel Quant has none remaining. He's in. Tim Paulson is in just ahead of Rob Forte. Frederick Agidius makes his way to the platform. Not sure if he's going to get that, but how smart was that idea? And Frederick Agidius does get in. He didn't even cross the line except for his shoe and ankle. That was brilliant.
Hey, when it comes to a sprint like that and you're running out of time, I'm not surprised some of these guys just take their chip and throw it across the finish line.
And I believe we're hearing that he's going to get time capped on that one. But Travis Williams did not have to worry about that. He beat the cap by over a minute, 10:58.62.
Well, we're waiting to see if some of these guys would pick up where the girls left off in their fourth heat, and that's to come out early and come out aggressive. And if you're going to pick one guy to do that in this heat, it is Travis Williams. He was got 29 reps in that first section, held on to that pace, and finished well ahead the rest of the field.
So two heats down, two heats remain in the 2-2-2-3 intervals. Men's event number 12 of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, Sam Farber with you at the Alliant Energy Center here in Wisconsin. And this one has just been interesting in terms of strategy and in terms of who can hang on through these four segments.
Every round starting with two rope climbs at 20 feet, followed by 10 cals on the skier. We'll do 3 2-minute sections, followed by 1 minute of rest and a final 3 minute section. Your goal is to get to 75 overhead squats within those time domains. That weight is 155 pounds.
And it's all about how many overhead squats you can get, but if you mess up the rope climbs, you're in trouble. For more on those, we go to Sam Farber.
Now, the rope climb might be where you lose a couple of rules you have to keep in mind. You have to touch the beam, not the portion of the apparatus where the rope is tied around. You also have to drop below the black line mid rope and have control of it still. If either of those two things don't happen, you get no rep. And as we've seen throughout this competition, that could absolutely obliterate any chance to get to the overhead squats at all that round.
Thank you, Sam. Here in heat number three, I feel like every single event this weekend, there's been both Andersons in the field in the same heat. We have it once again with Alex Anderson in lane six, Cody Anderson in lane two.
When we talk about the daughters all the time, how about the sons on the men's division, and specifically Cody Anderson? You're talking rope climbs, skier. We need some endurance and capability. But then you talk about overhead squats at 155. I know that's heavy relative to his body weight, but Cody Anderson is pound for pound, one of the strongest people in this field. He also has great positioning. The strongest guy in this field, Alex Anderson. So look for these two guys who have two different strikes and abilities to move into the front of this heat.
Two rope climbs, 10 calories on the skier. That will be every single 2 minute or 3 minute interval as we work through four separate segments. This one, the first of 3 2-minute intervals.
And we've been wanting to see these guys start out with a fast pace on these rope climbs and skier because you want to get as many squats as you can in that first round. Is that push the overhead squats. You don't want to go to failure so much, but you want to get a lot of reps in the bank. And to do that, they need to be clean. You don't want to be out of control on the bar and the rope. And then play the field. See where other people are at on the floor relative to your position after every round during those rest periods.
First to break away from the skier is Cody Mooney. Yonakowski is right behind him. Mooney in green and blue. Koski in the green tank top, center of the floor. Colt Sager was third in the black tank top on the bottom lane.
And with 50 seconds left to go, that is a lot of time when you're talking about overhead squats. This is a movement that you can cycle easily with if the bar is in the right position.
One of the training partners of Travis Williams is Cody Mooney, so I'm curious to see if that success will translate for the Misfit teammates. Cole Sager is a training partner of Katrin David's daughter who won this event on the women's side.
Cole Sager is one of those athletes that can bring his grip in very close, and what that allows you to do is to stabilize a lot more to where it's less about flexibility being an issue because he clearly has it. But the closer you get, the faster you can move without worrying about that bar falling from that overhead position.
In round number one, Travis Williams led the way at 29. Cole Sager in at 29. And for more on Cole, we go to Sam Farber.
Well, I talked to Cole just after the event was announced, asked him what he thought. He said, "This is my jam." I couldn't program a better event for me. He did add, however, during the previous event, that Madison triplet, that he caught his foot in one of those hay bales or straw bales, and he had a little bit of a hiccup there, so he wasn't all that positive how his squat was going to look. Obviously, it's looking just fine as he leads the way with 29 reps.
Thank you, Sam, and leads the way by 5 over Cody Mooney and Cody Anderson. As Cole Sager's name highlighted in blue, the leader will be that way the entire time on the top of the screen. Everybody else in red with that minus number indicating how far they are behind the lead as we're ready for segment number 2. Same buy-in, 2 rope climbs, 10 calories on the ski erg. This is the second of 3 2-minute intervals.
Look how fast Cole Sager is going up the rope, and what he has is a very good foot grab. He uses kind of like that side saddle where you wrap the foot around the side of your foot, and what that does is it allows your body weight to anchor for you as opposed to trying to squeeze the rope with your legs.
2 quick rope climbs for Sager, but he will find himself in the second position because Cody Mooney, once again, the fastest to the ski erg. Cole Sager is moving fast without looking like he's moving that fast through the buy-in portion.
Now, they say it in Olympic lifting, right? Smooth is fast, fast is smooth. When you have something like rope climbs, smooth climbs, good technique, good grabs. That is where you're going to move the fastest. Same thing with a skier. You don't have to be choppy and aggressive. If you're rowing for cows, albeit the skier or the rower, power per pull gives you more bang for your buck than short, choppy strokes.
Cody Mooney back on the bar. He'll snatch the first rep and get a couple in the bank before Cole Sager comes off the ski erg. Here comes Cole, but Cody Mooney has caught Sager for the lead.
Now Mooney dropped after the first set of 10 in the first round. He'll do it then. Now that's where he's going to lose some of his time. I wouldn't necessarily say dropping it all the way to the floor is a good idea because you can miss the grip or even the snatch that you're going to have to do from the floor. We saw Patson in the first heat do that behind the neck drop as he balance or snatch balance into it. What Cody's doing, or Cole's doing, is with that position. That's a good position for him. Then we have Alex Anderson. We're talking about strong legs and good positioning. This is one of the best guys in the field to do that as he's already moved up in that section of 39 to 42.
Interval 2 is now closed. We're in the 1-minute rest period. Cole Sager continuing to lead the way at 42 of 75 reps.
And as we're looking, Cody Anderson, watch his hand at the top where he touches. He just barely misses that, and that's enough time that he lost at the end. But if you're looking at the overall reps, Sager still maintaining a lead over both Alex Anderson and Cody Anderson with 42. I love the positioning overhead. As he goes down, what you want to look for is, do the shoulders rotate? Do the elbows buckle? Solid as a rock. That is a beautiful overhead squat by Cole Sager.
And the former University of Washington special team specialist and running back leading the way. And an event he said was his jam. He leads it by 1 rep over Alex and Cody Anderson, along with Garrett Fisher, the winner of event number 5, the 1 rep max snatch.
When we're talking about 1 rep, Cody Anderson is over the way in lane number 2 with the purple shorts and gray top. That misstep on the rope in the previous heat could be the difference of that 1 rep.
One of the fastest through the buy-in portion has been Cody Mooney, and I like that little slick way down that rope there as he just slides.
And what they want to see is that you show control down. You can slide down as fast as you want to, as long as you do a little stop or pause at the end. And Cody, he doesn't climb the ropes faster than any guy in this heat, but he does descend faster than any guy in this heat. And that's where he's making up time versus the other athletes in this heat.
Alex Anderson, second place, tied with Cody Anderson and Garrett Fisher, 3 reps behind Sager. He has 3 calories remaining on the skier.
You know, I know we show the top 3, but we have 7 guys separated by just 3 reps on the leaderboard. So this is a very tight heat.
overhead squats are started. We are working to the 8 minute mark here in our third 2 minute window. In lane number eight, that was Cody Mooney that had to go back a couple of steps because he got a no rep and he thought he was going to transition to that 45 square. He had to go back to the 42. That cost him a little bit of time. Cole Sager continuing to lead, but Alex Anderson has gained ground. And they're about a half rep apart of each other as Cole Sager, number 50 jersey, he's beyond rep number 50, trying to hold off Alex Anderson with 10 seconds remaining in interval number three.
Well, he's holding off Alex Anderson by holding on to the bar. We saw Alex Anderson drop it after 51 reps. Now, what Alex is doing better is he's getting to the bar sooner than Cole Sager, and he's also moving a little bit faster. But that speed and intensity from the beginning and during the reps, that can cause you to lose control and drop the bar.
So there's one interval remaining, and there's some time for these athletes to push. And for an update on them, we go to Sam Farber.
Well, before the event, when talking to the athletes, no one said themselves necessarily specifically, but they were fairly confident that multiple athletes would be through all 75 overhead squats and the first three two-minute intervals. It appears their eyes were a little bit bigger than their stomachs or their biceps or their quads, whatever muscle group you guys pick up there.
As we've yet to see anybody really come too close to that one. As 11 reps away was Travis Williams. He's the leader at 10:58.62. Can anybody catch it? They've got about 2 minutes to do so as we start our final interval. This one, the only one of 3 minutes.
The difference here is that Travis Williams only had to do 11 reps in his final round. And it's Cole Sager who's tied with Alex Anderson at 56 reps. That's 19 total reps he's going to have to try to make up on Travis Williams' time if he wants to beat him.
Cody Mooney for the fourth consecutive interval is the fastest through the two rope climbs to start, but he took a lot of time before starting on the ski erg.
And what Cody Mooney was doing is that he spent so much time going faster than everybody and then wasted it by adjusting his weight belt before getting onto the ski erg. You can do that when you finish the ski erg. You're gonna walk to your bar anyway. That was a complete waste of time for Cody Mooney.
1 minute down, 2 minutes remain as we work to the 12-minute overall time cap. This is the fourth and final interval, the lone three-minute interval. And despite putting on the weight belt, Mooney is still the first one away from the ski erg, but Alex Anderson is jogging past him. Mooney five reps behind the tie for the lead of Cole Sager and Alex Anderson. Sager walking on the inside lane on the bottom of the screen. So Alex Anderson will take the lead in the center lane in gray and purple.
What Alex needs to do is he needs to make sure that he gets that bar in a good position. His speed is perfectly fine. I don't know if he has enough in the tank to beat the time by Travis Williams, but he just got to make sure is that he does not have any room for error. One drop of that bar towards the end might be the difference between first and second.
Good news for Alex Anderson is beyond Travis Williams this time. You have to go another 41 seconds to get to the time of Jeff Patzer. Cole Sager is clipping off these reps in a hurry. We're having a scoring issue with his screen. But he's on the right side working towards rep number 69. It's working towards rep 72 for Alex Anderson. They're only separated by a couple of reps. Alex Anderson gets a no rep. The bar is on the ground. Cole Sager still has it locked out overhead. Three reps remain for Cole Sager. This will be good for second in the event. They're one rep apart. Anderson in the center of the screen. Sager on the bottom of the screen. Give the position to Alex Anderson, who still finds a way to hold off Cole Sager.
And I said previously, you got to make sure you have the bar in the right spot because a drop could cost you. It didn't end up costing him the position in this heat, but he made it very, very close with Cole Sager.
Final 15 seconds. Three athletes working in their final six reps. In lane number seven, Garrett Fisher, Cody Mooney, Lucas Esslinger, all in the mix of trying to finish under the time cap. Garrett Fisher is done with the work. He's up on the platform, as is Cody Anderson. Oh, did either of them beat the time cap? Does not look like they got across the line in time, but it wasn't for a lack of effort.
I thought Cody Anderson had it. He finished with 3 seconds left, but he had a slight hesitation before finishing across the finish line. But fantastic effort from both athletes.
That's what you call selling out. Cody Anderson and Garrett Fisher still sprawled out on the platform after baseball slides onto the finish line. And it was pretty much a baseball slide that determined this one here between Alex Anderson and Cole Sager.
Well, Anderson dropped the bar twice in the round of 72, but hold on when it counted as between him and Cole Sager. He got the bar up. Sager moved into 75 on the left side ahead of Anderson, but Anderson's squat pace was just that much faster than Cole Sager.
Anderson will win the heat. It'll be good for the second fastest time thus far. Travis Williams' time still stands with one heat remaining. And it is time for that fourth and final heat in men's event number 12 at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. And I think a little bit quietly, Dave Castro issued the challenge to Matt Fraser when it came to this one about finishing in 3 intervals instead of 4. And why not? Matt Fraser nearly 200 points clear of the rest of the field.
Well, he's got to get challenged somewhere. We have CrossFit Games version of red light, green light, a little stop and go action. 2 minutes of work, 1 minute of rest for 3 rounds, finishing with a final AMRAP of 3 minutes. The goal is to get 75 overhead squats at 155.
You can get your money on the overhead squats, but you can certainly go broke on the rope climbs. For more there, we go to Sam Farber.
Two key things to keep in mind. One, at the top of the rope climb, the athletes must touch the beam, not the anchor where you see the rope secured. If they only touch the anchor, that's a no rep. Also, on the descent, they have to get both hands beneath the black line and still maintain control of the rope. If they don't, that's a no rep and could destroy their chance of fitting any overhead squats in during any particular interval.
Thank you, Sam. 1 year ago, we were blown away by the dominance of Matt Fraser. His lead already this year is larger than the final standings gap a year ago. He's up 198 and in lane number 5.
Well, he got issued the challenge from Dave Castro. Now, he doesn't necessarily need to take that risk to finish this round in 3. But what he wants to do is to go out there and compete. If anyone has the chance to do this, Matt Fraser is one of those guys.
Two men that made the move earlier today in event number 11 in the second and third. Brent Fikowski on the right, Ricky Garrard on the left.
Ricky Garrard coming off an event win. I would like to see how this carries on into this one.
The buy-in is underway for our first of 4 intervals, the first of 3 2-minute ones. 2 rope climbs to the top of that just incredibly tall Rogue A-frame rig. And then they'll have 10 calories on the skier. And Brent Fikowski, he had the event record in an event that had 10 rope climbs in regionals by over a minute faster than Matt Fraser's second fastest time. And he's smooth on the rope climbs the first time, but he struggled on the second one.
He's very smooth and he's very long. And he chews up a lot of ground with those strokes. We had one little bit of a misstep, I think a little too slow between his transitions. He can clean that up in the next round. If you want to win, you're going to have to push the pace of the squats in this round. There's no pacing, there's no gaming. Get the work done, but make sure you do it with clean repetitions. Do not get sloppy in the overhead squat position. Say play the rest of the field while you're resting. Look around in between. If you're these guys, it doesn't matter. Every time I get my hands on the bar, I'm selling out.
Virtually the entire heat got to the bar at the same time. They were all separated by only about 4 seconds. And Matt Fraser, you put a barbell in his hand, he's going to be happy all day long as he's in the mix for the lead. But the first man to take a step forward is Noah Olson. We spoke about it with Travis Williams. Travis Williams will run through the brick wall, as you pointed, on night number one. Noah Olson is another one of those guys.
He loves to go out fast, and he'll go out fast early. Noah Olson has a decent overhead position when it comes to this specific movement with the overhead squat, and he's not afraid to go for it. He lost that second place position this morning after Ricky Garrard won the event earlier with the runs and burpees over the straw bales. Noah Olson needs to get some points back in this event.
And this should be the highest rep count we'll see from anybody in the opening interval. 30 reps in the books for Noah Olson. For more on him, we go to Sam Farber.
Well, these athletes haven't had a whole lot of time to strategize on this event, but most of our analysts have said pace is going to be the key. When I asked Noah Olsen about it, he said, no, this is a sprint. He is looking at this as an opportunity to possibly finish in three intervals, the first three intervals, and if nothing else, give himself very little work to do in that fourth and final interval.
Thank you, Sam. Noah Olsen leading the way, but when Dave Castro said it's impossible for anybody to finish this in three intervals, the look on Matt Fraser's face said challenge accepted, and he's through 29 of 75 reps after the opening interval.
And he's ahead of the pace mathematically. You need to average 25 reps per two-minute section to get those 75 within the first three rounds.
Interval two underway. We work to the 5-minute mark on the overall clock. Same thing, two rope climbs, 10 calories on the ski erg, as many overhead squats as you can get from then on out. Brent Fikowski struggled on that second rep of the two rope climbs, but he still sits in the fourth position, six reps behind Olsen. That's a nice recovery. He missed the beam. He missed the beam twice, but he still held himself up at the top and will still be the first one through the rope climbs.
Now what happens there is that puts a lot of stress on your grip, especially if you go up, think you're done. You have to squeeze down hard so you don't slide down the rope. That can hurt him a little bit later if he can't recover well.
Black tank top is Noah Olsen, one lane over from that man, the professor, Brent Fikowski. Olsen's name highlighted in blue because he is the current event leader. Everybody else will be highlighted in red. The minus number showing how far they are behind the lead in terms of reps as we're 1 minute away from stopping interval number two. It's Fikowski one, Vellner two, and Ricky Garrard third to the barbell. Garrard, no shirt, black shorts, left side of the screen. New leader, Matt Fraser. Mathematically, he needs to be beyond rep number 50 if he wants to finish this event. In terms of the squat number in three intervals, he'll drop it down to his shoulders and go straight into that snatch balance for rep number 37.
Really like the move by Matt Fraser. We haven't seen too many guys do that since Jeff Patzer in the first round. Now, he didn't opt for it for the second opportunity, but if you don't feel confident in your stability as you walk, drop it down to your shoulders. Noah Olsen is followed behind these guys after coming off of that blistering 30 to start.
Olsen finds himself in third, about a half rep behind Brent Fikowski, who's moved up to second. And there was one little thing that Matt Fraser was doing that looked really kind of subtle. He would walk all the way to the front of the square that he's doing his squats in, take one step forward after three, do his next three, and that's when he would drop it to his back and walk at the farther distance. But it was a different story for Noah Olsen here in interval two.
Well, he's having some missteps with his feet, and look at his fingers. He almost has a fingertip grip as opposed to a full palm grab. And as he gets to the top, sliding through, see that rope slip through his hands? That can really hurt your grab. Look at the power Matt Fraser is putting into this skier. Full body. You want to get a big high reach, drive your chest down, and let your body wave through that.
But the man that had more overhead squats than anybody in the second interval is in purple. That's Brent Fikowski, who's now just one rep behind Matt Fraser as we start interval number three.
What Brent Fikowski did in the second round is that he had a much cleaner run on the rope climbs than he did on the first round. That gave him more time on the bar for those overhead squats.
Matt Fraser threw 46 of 75 needed overhead squats to complete the event. Fikowski threw 45, Olsen 43. As we work towards the 8-minute mark on the overall timer, which will end interval number three. Fraser actually changing the damper setting before he starts on the skier.
Well, what did we say right off the bat of things to look for? Adaptability. Round per round, you're going to have to adapt as things change. Maybe in that second round it was too high. And when you do that, there's a risk reward there. If you have too high of a damper, the heaviness of that pull starts to be a detriment towards the end when you get fatigued. If that's the case, you want to drop the damper setting a little bit and make the resistance a little bit lighter on your way through.
Brent Fikowski will make the breakaway from the ski erg first. Patrick Vellner in the bright yellow shirt, lane number three, in second. Matt Fraser in the red leader shorts is in third. Ricky Garrard will break away fifth from the ski erg as he sits in the third and final provisional podium position.
What's important here is that regardless of what you feel like, you have to go as hard as you can now. This is the moment to maximize as many overhead squats as you can. As Garrard is working, he doesn't look quite as confident and stable as you would say Matt Fraser does to the bottom right part of your screen. And what they're trying to do is hold off Noah Olsen at the same time trying to chase down the champ on the left side.
Olsen is fading into the background in terms of the shot and the lead battle. Matt Fraser and Brent Fikowski, rep for rep, give the one rep lead to Matt Fraser as we close out the third of four intervals.
And that was a very smart move by Matt Fraser. It might have only been one rep, but he was behind one. He made up two in this specific. If you're looking at total reps to go, these guys are 14 and 15 reps out of that 75. Fikowski had one of the least amount of overhead squats completed in round one, the most in round two, and he had a good start to this third section for round number three, where he ran to the bar, bought himself some time. But what that did was, is that Matt Fraser got to the bar and he moves a little bit better than Brent Fikowski. But Fikowski, always cognizant of what's going on. We say he is probably the most cerebral athlete onto the competition floor. A little peek out the corner of his eyes to see where Matt Fraser is.
Fourth and final interval. It's the only interval of 3 minutes. The time to beat, 10 minutes, 58.62 seconds. Travis Williams did that with only 11 reps remaining. Matt Fraser has 14 remaining, Fikowski 15.
Fraser was about third off the descent on the rope climbs, but first to get back on there for his second attempt. Fraser is going for it in this fourth and final round.
Patrick Vellner breaking first to the skier. In terms of the battle for third place coming out of this event, Ricky Garrard will be just ahead of Noah. Actually, I take that back. Noah Olsen got a no rep on the rope climb. You saw him making his way back up for his second rep. So Noah Olsen, who only got one overhead squat in round number three, and he no reps again as he comes off the rope. And this could be the end of the road for Noah Olsen's podium hopes.
And what he did in the first round, like he said, it's the most overhead squats we've seen by any male athlete in the field. But what was the cost of that?
He entered this event fourth place, 28 points behind Ricky Garrard for third. And this crowd has just come alive as simultaneously walking to their bars, Brent Fikowski and Matt Fraser. Fraser going for the snatch right out of the gate.
Fraser looking to his left, seeing if Fikowski has moved into his sections.
30 seconds until Travis Williams' 10 minute 58.62 time. Matt Fraser has it in his sights, as does Brent Fikowski, who's three reps behind. But Matt Fraser has been marching down the warpath, not just this season, but last season as well. And he continues to march down the floor here in this event. Three event wins in his first 3 years, four this weekend from Matt Fraser. Brent Fikowski will wrap up third in the event, second in the heat, and he might be solidifying himself a second place position. Ricky Garrard having to drop the bar and walk away from it. And Noah Olsen all by himself back on the ski erg with only 35 seconds remaining. Garrard looking very distressed as he's struggling to get this bar up back overhead. He's lost position to Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson. He's lost position to Patrick Vellner. Scott Panchik has gone by. 20 seconds remaining until the 12-minute time cap. Overall, Panchik is ahead. Gudmundsson is ahead. Panchik in the center of the screen. Gudmundsson in the blue t-shirt. Scott Panchik up onto the platform. He'll be third place in the heat at 10 minutes or 11 minutes 50 seconds. Ricky Garrard will lose another spot, this one to Ben Smith. And Ricky Garrard had a huge huge moment of gaining ground on Noah Olsen, but they both came unraveled in the fourth interval.
I have to see what happened to Noah Olsen on that last rope climb, because that ended up being his undoing.
Noah told Sam Farber before this heat, there's not much strategy, it's a sprint. And it did not work for him.
Well, he said it before. You want to go as fast as you can without sacrificing or going to muscle failure. And you can see him falling off the rope, and that's what happened. But Matt Fraser, I mean, what more can you say about this guy? There's really nothing left you can throw at him other than just ridiculous challenges from Dave Castro about how fast he can win an event by.
So Matt Fraser getting his fourth event win of the weekend, but it's a completely different story for Noah Olsen, 38th in event number 12, and he will go in a free fall down the point standings as Fraser wins this one by about 4 seconds over Travis Williams, his former time to beat all the way back in heat number two. Brent Fikowski rounds out the top three, but Matt Fraser is with Sam Farber.
Matt, there are a lot of athletes in a lot of sports who, when they have a big lead, coast across the finish line. You clearly are not doing that. What is it in you that keeps you driving, even though the title of fittest on earth is probably yours?
It's not over till it's over. I've been ahead by 100 points before and kind of coasted, and it backfired, and I'll never make that mistake again.
In terms of the head-to-head race within each event, you always have this awareness of where every other athlete is on the floor. How does their performance drive you and impact the way you strategize?
I try to just run my own race. Being aware they are, you know, it's just reassurance that, okay, I'm attacking this correctly and just keep doing what I'm doing.
Last year we talked around the same time and we talked about what you would work on, and you said you work on your weakness. Everyone who does CrossFit is constantly trying to improve. What is it specifically that you do when you go into the gym to work on whatever weaknesses Dave Castro hasn't found yet?
You know, I keep doing the movement until I'm fucking good at it.
You're pretty good, Matt. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, he's pretty good. We'll lay out on the rest of that phrase, but Matt Fraser, it's just unbelievable what he's done the past 2 years. Last year in 15 events, he had 1,096 points. This year in 12 events, 1,038. Only 58 points less than he's done when he had 15 points a year ago.
At the same time, over a 200-point lead over second place Brent Fikowski, and Ricky Garrard did enough in that event to have a solid stranglehold on third place. Vellner now playing the, you know, Fikowski role of last year, sitting in fourth place on the outside looking in.
And Noah Olsen has dropped all the way down to sixth place, and it looks like his podium hopes for the very first time might be gone. But Matt Fraser looking like he's got this one wrapped up, but we still have some work to do. They're about to find out what is left for them, and we will have the coverage of that when that is revealed and when we get ready for our coverage in a few moments from now.
Four, five. He's going to come back to these really big kettlebells, and he's going to do five deadlifts. One, two, three, four, five. He's going to go back to the wall. Don't worry about advancing them. I'll have them do that. You don't have to. And he's going to do eight handstand push-ups on the parallettes. Two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. He's going to come back to the kettlebells, and he's going to do eight kettlebell deadlifts. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, and 8. He's going to go back to the wall and do 13 handstand push-ups. One, two, three, let's count them, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, four more. Nine, 10.
Is that 10?
10. 11. 12. 13. He's going to come over here, and he's going to do 13 kettlebell deadlifts. Go ahead, take your time. 2, 3, 4, 5. Come on, let's hear it for our demo team who's been putting in work all weekend. Four more. Let's go, finish strong. 13, let's give him a round of applause. We tested your overhead stability with the barbell and the squat. As soon as this is over, we're gonna test your overhead stability with 2 kettlebells and a lunge. You finish that, pick up the kettlebells, get them overhead, both of them, and lunge 89 feet across the floor. You don't have to go the whole way, but go ahead and show a couple. 1.5 pood for the men, 1 for the women. Let's cheer them on. Let's get them to go all the way. From Canada, Albert Dominique LaRouche. Let's go, Madison! Bring him in! Great job, Albert. All right, that's the final event. One little thing, the women's reps for the handstand push-ups are 3, 5, 8. The women are doing 3, 5, 8 because they're really deep. They're really deep parallel handstand push-ups. And the men, you're doing 5, 8, 13. The kettlebell reps for both genders are 5, 8, 13. All right, head back so you can get the brief from Boz and we can set the floor for the team final.
So we now know how the individuals are going to finish their 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. But before we get to looking at to the final event, we're going to recap what we just saw the individuals throw down on the Coliseum floor in the 2-2-2-3 intervals. And we're going to start with the men and we'll start with the women. And a little bit of a mishap that happened there at the on the final heat with Kara Webb in particular. And here's what happened with Kara. She was heading towards her final set of squats. She was in the round of 72. She had three more squats left. You can see her judge standing there on the 75 rep mat. And she got sent along to the finish line. She still had three reps to go. We're going to take another look at that from a different angle. You can see her standing clearly in the 72 rep range. She still had three more reps to go. She was released to the finish line, but it was corrected eventually. What happened was they went back and they filmed and found out how long it took her to complete those last three reps, and they assessed that penalty to her, assuming she would have done three more. So that was 6 seconds added to her time. Director of the games, Dave Castro, letting her know the decision, everything all good. It would drop her from second in the event down to fourth in the event. A few places switch hands there. Annie Thor's daughter, Kristen Bolton, moves up there. And it would actually still be a strong finish for Kara, despite the fact that she did not complete all of the reps, but it was still sorted out. Overall standings going into the final event. And we basically have a win and you're in situation at the top between Tia Claire Toomey and Kara Webb. Just 6 points separated. If either of these two women win the final event, they will be the CrossFit Games champion. Annie Thor's daughter holding strong into third and final podium. And then two more Icelandic women right behind them. Annie Thor's daughter and Tamil Reed Berline have had a back and forth day ever since day number two. This is their standings after day number two for the last 6 events. Annie started in fifth, has worked her way slowly back and forth into that third and final podium spot. Tennille Reed went from third to our overall leader at one point, but has slowly slid down into sixth heading into the final event. Now, over to the men's side of things. And we just saw the men finish up in the finale of the 2-2-2-3 intervals. And we had a bit of a sad moment, if you will, with Noah Olsen. An unfortunate turn of events for him in that final. He came out hot, but maybe a little bit too hot, Dan.
Yeah, the guys that talked to him in the back said that he kind of viewed this event as a sprint, and he did more overhead squats in the first round than any other athlete, got no rep on a rope climb, then failed, and that might cost him a shot at the podium.
Yeah, he did not come down far enough before he let go of the rope, and it was a heartbreaking event for Noah Olsen. But the race to watch was once again Brent Fikowski and Matt Fraser coming down to the wire. Matt Fraser, I mean, seriously, it's just ridiculous at this point how good he is. Another event win in front of the Coliseum crowd. He walks away at 10:54.63 for the event win in event number 12. Travis Williams from an earlier heat, nice to see him at the top of the leaderboard in that event. Brent Fikowski would finish third. Alex Anderson, Cole Sager, a couple of pipe hitters we expected to see at the top. Jeff Patzer, Scott Penchek, nice results for them. Tim Paulson notches a top 10 finish for the rookies. And this is your overall standings going into the final event. Matt Fraser just has to get through this event. It's pretty much sewn up for him. He's got a 210-point lead over second place. Brent Fikowski. Brent solidly in second. Ricky Garrard, the rookie, solidly in third. Some impressive performances overall from those particular athletes going into the final. Should be exciting still, nonetheless, on the men's side. We just heard Dave Castro, guys, give us an announcement for what the final event was going to be, and here are the details for you guys at home. It's called the Fibonacci Final. 5-3-8 reps of handstand push-ups for the men and 203-pound kettlebell deadlifts. This is for the men. They're going to use once they're done with that, they're going to use a 53-pound kettlebell overhead walking lunge. They're going to have two kettlebells overhead. They're going to lunge the entire length of the floor. Time cap is 6 minutes. The women's version of this, very similar, but just a slight adjustment for reps. 3-5-8 reps on the handstand push-ups, and then same reps for the men as 124-pound kettlebell deadlifts. Once they're done, they'll grab a 35-pound kettlebell, a pair of them. They'll do the overhead lunge to the finish line, 89 feet. Time cap is 6 minutes. It's called the Fibonacci Final because the Fibonacci is a sequence of numbers where the next number in the sequence is the sum of the previous two. So you saw the 3-5-8 there. 8 is the sum of 5 and 3. Dave Castro apparently is a math whiz when he programmed this. So
apparently really good at math.
Yeah, likes to throw us for a loop. So thinking about these events, guys, and going into the final event, who do you like here to finish out the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games?
Women go first?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the fight from Tia and Kara is going to be insane. The stress that I'm going to be feeling watching it is going to be very, very high. They both need to stay cool and collected. and both need to see themselves winning. I am going to say, though, this workout has Katrin's name written all over it. So keep an eye on Katrin, and let's see a great performance coming from her as well.
Quick one, Dan.
I mean, I'm going to go with Frazier. I think that he wants to end the weekend with a bang. He's basically shown everybody, he's like, hey, I'm the guy. The weekend's not even over, but I'm the fittest man on earth. I think he's going to end it with an exclamation point.
Well, surprise, surprise. Dan Bailey picks Matt Frazier.
I think you've picked him.
Hey, and I've been right a lot.
Yeah, you have.
That's going to do it for us right now. We're going to send you guys back out to the Coliseum 4 for the final event for the team competitions, Team Event 12, to close out the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games for them.
Four, two-time Games veterans, CrossFit OC.